棒棒的事哈，就是你刚才在讲这个过程里面，就是关于这个参与啊，或者是一个公民参与的一些技术或者一个新的发展啊，你特别提到那个南韩的一些新的东西，一些新的做法这样。那但是就像我早上也稍微提过一下，我想大家在座可能很多朋友也知道，就是说比如说南韩的核能啊，核能发展啊，那个简直是就是说当全世界因为车诺比事件这个大家都刹车的时候，南韩是继续加速进行发展这样的东西这样。所以我就不太清楚你举的那个像南韩那样子的一个参与机制啊，那个机制有没有在最近曾经发挥过任何作用啊，特别是对核能而言这样。因为我的了解好像是核能这个南韩现在非常热衷啊，而且还外销啊到阿拉伯国家或等等之类这样的东西。这样的话也许对于我们来讲的话，可以在台湾这个脉络里面可以进一步了解一下。那另外我想问一下那个张罗辉张老师的一个问题，大概也是我想是关于这个法国这个发展的。我想刚才我听你的讲法，或者是我想是 Professor Schneider 的一个讲法，就是比较是有点像是过去一个所谓的 technocrats 的一个这样子一种方式来描述说法国的一个这样子的一个好像被 technocrats 所绑架，或者是他 dominate 然后来发展。那当然在某个程度上我们也可以了解说的确是如此，像法国自己世报核爆在南太平洋等等之类，他做很多很多事情，他都想要独立，或者是独立美国系统之外啊，建立起一个自己的现在一个欧洲的一个这样。但是我就是好奇，就是说法国的核能能够到80%这样的地步，就是说法国的民间哈，在就是好像没有什么抗衡力量，好像就是说就是让这个法国的 technocrats 就这样子一直发展一直发展这样的东西。那我还刚刚还想到说，法国在60年代末还有这个震惊世界的这个学生运动啊，和各式各样的反抗什么这样的东西。那为什么好像这种对于这个法国的 technocrats 好像说我不知道，就是是不是有产生任何的制衡力量？那我想今天刚好有几位法国学者，包括 Paul 啊等等之类的，我想是不是能够 enlighten 我们这个关于这个方面的问题？谢谢。
好，谢谢傅老师的提问哦。那我刚刚其实是有提到南韩他们在科技基本法的这样的一个制度化，不过其实我刚刚有提到他们比较针对信息科技，然后强化这样的一个公民参与的机制，所以在我印象中比较是说像是这种科技啊或是 STEM cell 之类的这种公民参与。但是人员这部分核能，我确实要回去做一些功课哦。我不晓得这可能，那我觉得其实在我印象中，可能如果说就这样的情况下，可能就是核能这一块他们还没有，因为我就知道他们比较是新兴科技这一块。那我觉得说，其实我在讲那个比较是对于核能的这个政策，一方面就是说要制度化嘛。那一方面其实我觉得是很大一部分是那个公民社会运动这种力量。那我不晓得，如果说南韩这样的话，我不知道他们其实也牵涉到整个公民力量能不能去影响那个既定的政策方向。那所以我现在在做一方面是希望说这个制度化公民参与嘛，那针对这个能源啊或是核能政策。那另外一方面我觉得公民社会这一部分，其实一方面在做这个参与式科技并用，一方面其实也是带动这个公民社会的这个力量或是承受的发展。其实我也是很呼应刚刚国辉老师讲到那个，其实我之前在做核废料，我有讲，也是在讲到这种有点像是这种跨国跨文化这种 ally building， 这种就是有点像是说我们可以跨合作这种东亚，是其他甚至像 Greenpeace 啊，或其实不局限在东亚，我觉得其实是那样子，也许可以形成一股力量，然后两方面在制度化，或者说在公民社会里。南韩这份确实是可以去深究的，就是说不管是在他们的基本法针对新兴科技，我是觉得那部分其实是我们可以学，但是河南这部分可以再去了解。谢谢。
谢谢傅老师的提问。那其实这个问题就是说，为什么法国后来还是就是好像没有，就是一直还是一直发核能，就是说，其实我觉得某种程度也可以对应，是说，为什么福岛核灾之后，韩国就是像刚刚，韩国还是继续走，然后日本。 很快也宣布它要继续开，那台湾的核试也没办法停，那中国更是一直停，所以就是说到底危机哦，就是说我们一直在讲说，除非像这种大型技术系统在面临危机的时候，才有可能会有一点转变的。但是，我觉得法国有趣的意思就是说，它第就是也让我们看到1973年石油危机其实是增强了，增强了它要继续盖更多的核电了。那这个解释就变成是说，当然危机没有办法解释哦，危机反而增强。那另外一个就是我想这是我今天引用的这位作者，他很有趣，我觉得是蛮有趣的一点观点，就是说，还是要看一看整个的法国的脉络。如果说当科技变成是一个国家的目标而不是手段的时候，有这样子的脉络，这么强的脉络，那这个脉络不只是technocrats 他这样认为，是可能法国人，那特别是法国工程师，相较于其他的职业哦，他的社会地位相较于律师或是医生，他有很强的一个传统，就是说工程师是更强的一个这样的情形之下，所以这个脉络是很强的，也就是说。那我不晓得能不能，其实我不晓得这样是不是有回答这个问题，就是说当这个脉络很强的时候，可能危机没有办法去 stop 或者说改变，那看得出来就是说东亚可能也有这样子的脉络，所以但我这边讲的是好像就是很抽象啊，很广泛，就是说法国为什么后来还是这么多，就是说我想脉络力量可能是还蛮强的，就是整个在 push 他们觉得科技其实是目标而不是手段。
Okay, perhaps we can ask Yannick and Michael to give some complimentary comments on the, why France has I mean, as far as I know, but Yannick and Michael know better than me, France used to have a strong anti-nuclear movement in the 1970s, at least until the famous book published by sociologist Touraine was in the beginning of the 1980s. Beginning of the first French socialist government, it was almost as strong as the German anti-nuclear movement. But Michael, you're very welcome to comment on this. But I think what the weird point was that the unions, labor unions, and especially the communist-affiliated CGT, was very much in favor of nuclear energy for reasons that have been explained in the book by Gabriel Asch, The Redence of France. But now, can you comment?
No, I agree to the comment of Paul, because I think... It's not an answer, but just a remark on the question of technocracy. I think it's difficult to talk about technocracy because we don't know exactly what is. It's a kind of a black box to explain why France is like that. It's always technocracy. But I think it's when you look at closer, for example, the nuclear lobby. You can see that, for example, now there is a lot of tension between nuclear agencies inside this lobby. I'm not saying that there is no nuclear lobby, but what is interesting is to see that each agency has its goal and purpose in this story. And for example, in nuclear waste policy, it's very clear that ANDRA has not the same purpose than EDF, for example. So what I'm saying is that when we talk about...
I'm sorry, but that's not obvious. For me, at least, it's not obvious. Can you explain why it's EDF and...
ANDRA? Because it's simple, because EDF is on the market. And, for example, but Michael could correct me if I'm wrong, but the strategy of EDF with nuclear waste is to have a cheaper nuclear waste, and sometimes it's not easy with this kind of waste to for the disposal. You understand? Andra, seek to have. Maybe can you? It's a problem of language here, Michael. Can you explain the fact that in French, EDF cherche par exemple à faire des déchets même beaucoup plus chauds, mais beaucoup plus remplis, et ça complique le disposal, en fait, le stockage des déchets nucléaires ultimes.
We are in the technical part now.
Yeah. it's important. The technician. It's important.
Okay, can you help me?
I'm not sure it's that important, but it's an example, which illustrates what Yannick is trying to say. It's that, for example, EDF, to save money on final disposal costs, would rather see small packages, because it's the volume that makes the costs. So they would rather have higher activity but smaller volumes per package. And it's a problem for the waste management agency because they, you know, dealing with smaller, hotter packages is a more complex problem than and it's an issue of technical specifications, what you allow onto a final disposal site. However, I think what is more significant, if I may add, profiting of the microphone, may add to this, I think the point you made before is more significant. Like, EDF is in a market situation where they actually have to compete with other electricity generators. And it's today a completely different situation than even 10 years ago. So the cost pressure has increased phenomenally. And it's a very different situation for an electricity generator than for the management agency of nuclear waste, which, you know, they get their money whatever they do, right? And they're a service provider, so they get paid per waste package by the producers of waste. The other point I wanted to make concerning two points. One is on opposition. Paul, you said the French movement was as strong as the German one. In fact, it's historically even older than the anti-nuclear movement as such started in France, not in Germany. It swept over the border from the Fessenheim movement to Germany, but not the other way around. What happened, it's a long story, of course, but what happened basically is that there were a number of key events. One was 1976, a very large demonstration with 50,000 people, a site occupation in Kreismalbilde against the fast breeder reactor, turned sour, and the riot police used offensive grenades. One person got killed, and another person lost a hand, a foot. Like it was a war, like a war. I've seen footage. You wouldn't believe it. It's like a war kind of situation. And this was deeply traumatizing for the anti-nuclear movement in France. It, because it basically demonstrated that the French state was ready to kill people in order to implement the nuclear program, which was a real, you know, fundamental shock. And the second event, which I consider personally as very significant, is when the Mitterrand government came in 1981, the only existing national infrastructure with technical expertise in the nuclear field was the socialist-affiliated trade union CFDT. And basically, literally all the leaders of the CFDT trade union in 1981 joined the state, the Agency for Energy Efficiency, under an unwritten deal, which was basically they get a lot of money to do efficiency and renewables, but they don't talk about nuclear power. And this had it was like taking the cream off the sort of intellectual movement in France. And finally, you know, the specific historic situation, why the CGT, like the Communist Trade Union, which has always been, since the war, majority, had the majority at EDF was the nationalization law in 1946, which provided to the what is called the Oeuvre Sociale, which is like the social works, 1% of the turnover. Now, 1% of the turnover given to a sort of a para-institutional thing, right, which is managed by the trade unions according to their majority share. So 1% of turnover, we're talking hundreds of millions right now, right, even now. And that was managed by the Communist Trade Union. By the way, that's one of the reasons why the Communist Party survived, because it subsidized the Communist Party. Oh, that's not official, of course. But, it, you know, I mean, there is, it is very clear that it had a huge impact on social peace. Social peace was guaranteed through the 1% rule and public, the public status of EDF.
Thank you very much. British comments. More questions?